think this works. Okay, it does. Thank you, everybody, for joining us on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. It takes a lot to want to come learn about Jim Crow segregation in the country on this sort of day, but happy to see you all here and delighted to be holding space and conversation with Dr. Burnham.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Courtney. It's great to be in Chicago. It's great to be here at the Chicago Humanities Festival. Check that off my bucket list. This is fabulous. Just wonderful to be here.
We're checking it off today here together. So very, very, very exciting. And so I am holding the book that was going to be the kind of focus of our discussion today. And as soon as I got this book, I could tell by the title that I was going to be intrigued, to say the least. But beyond intrigued, I can say from, you know, reading the book, reading through the book, as many historians know, you got to give yourself time sometimes with these sorts of things. I would describe this book as powerful. I would describe this book as devastating. And I would describe this book as crucial, and reminded me a lot of the movement most recently around saying those names, saying the names of people who we have lost to violence, whether via the state or indirectly via the state. We could get into that, but I wanted to just at least say some of the names of this book that really struck me, whether it was Lily Mae Hendon, Bobby Hall, Viola Edwards, Booker Spicely. There's names across these pages who we never got to say and never got to give justice to. And so that made this hard. This is also, again, a hard read, but an important read. Can you describe the process of writing this book? How was it in general, just, you know, being able to write something like this?
Well, thanks. Thanks, Professor Joseph, for that question. So yes, saying the names is a large mission of the book, that I am trying to recover and unearth the names of individuals who lost their lives to Jim Crow violence from 1920s through the 1950s. So I wanted to give a sense of their stories, of the casual nature of the incidents that led to their deaths, and to recover their lives, and also just to recover the very humdrum and ordinariness of the violence. But I also wanted to tell a more complex story about how the violence created a legal system very different from what we commonly understand to be the American legal system, how it influenced, so how it created a law that was more politics than a legal system based more on politics than on evidence, as it were. And so I use the stories in many ways, first, as I say, to give life to those who were rendered invisible by the violence, but as well to tell equally important story about politics and law during the mid-20th century. That, I think, has not been well told.
Definitely not well told, especially in schools. I often joke with my students that, you know, the extent of Black history that they learn, if anything, prior to college is, you know, there were slavery. It was bad. It was only in the South, though. It was slavery. It was bad. And then Lincoln, and shout out to Illinois, you know, land of Lincoln, he freed the slaves. And then Martin Luther King Jr. came along 100 years later, not really no understanding of why we would need a Martin Luther King Jr. or a civil rights movement at that point. And then he fixed it again, even though we don't know what the it is fully. And then everything should have been fine. And then look, Obama. And so those, you know, kind of just flat history, you're really telling a big missing piece and, you know, how Jim Crow is still so much with us. Tied to that, for me, is thinking about how this book rectifies the violence of the archive, historical archive, right? That oftentimes when historians have to do this work, if we want to do work on this sort of thing, we're told, well, there's no real documentation of it. And so how do you even do this work if you don't have the stories to tell? But your archival work that you've done with the digital project, and you know, just the book itself speaks against that. Can you talk about what it was like to kind of like put an archive together for something like this?
Well again, the archive, you have to look at the archive in two dimensions. First of all, it's the narrative. It provides the narrative of the story. And by archive, Courtney, we're talking about documents that are available, but not readily available. They are documents stored in the National Archives at College Park, the records of the Department of Justice and the FBI, records of the NAACP and other advocacy organizations that were active during this period of time that are archived at the Library of Congress, as well as newspaper articles, mostly newspaper materials from the African American press. So those really form the basis for each one of the stories that we tell. It's also true that we are able to lift up many stories that for which the documentation is really quite thin. And I want to share one with you that is one I begin the book with. It's the story of a woman by the name of Ollie Hunter. And her name would have, but for the work that my students and I did, today be unknown. Ollie Hunter is a woman whose story was conveyed to the NAACP in the early 1940s by a writer who gives his name but not her name because he doesn't know her. He's writing from a little small town in Georgia called Donaldsonville, Georgia. And he tells the story of a elderly African-American woman who goes into a shop on the main street. You imagine what a main street in a small town in Donaldsonville, Georgia in 1942, 1943 looked like. Maybe four or five shops. The black folk entered from the back of the shop. The white folk entered from the front of the shop. She goes in the shop. She picks up a can. And so incensed is the storekeeper, who is a 20-some-odd-year-old white man, by something she had done that had something to do with the can or the way she picked up the can, that he walks out of follows her out of the shop, and he beats her to death on the main street in Donaldsonville, Georgia, with an axe, with an axe handle. And her story, if her story lies in the archive at all, it's because of the letter in which she is anonymous, written to the NAACP, in which the guy pleads, can you please do something here? We pick up that letter, and from there we're able to find out who she is by matching the dates in the letter with the death certificates from Donaldsonville, and also maybe able to figure out who the perpetrator is, and may be able to connect the perpetrator to the fact that he and his brothers were sent off to fight in World War II shortly after this incident, and certainly able to pick up that no readily available documents in any court account for the life and very brutal death of Ollie Hunter. And I start the book with that story because, first of all, it reveals what the archive can reveal, but also what's missing from the archive. And also it tells us a lot about the vulnerability of both women and men to this sort of violence that, when you think about Jim Crow, everybody knows about Emmett Till. Everybody knows about Rosa Parks. But as you say, there are other cases and perspectives on the period, understandings of the history and legacy of the period that only come from deep dives and usage of the archive in the way that we have been able to do here. And let me just say one other thing before I turn it back over to you, which is this work should have been done long ago. And I argue in my book, each of us has an obligation to carry forward the stories that are right behind us. Mm-hmm. As if we don't do it, it won't get done. And so I'm looking at this period, I'm not a kid, so I grew up was born in a segregated hospital in Birmingham, Alabama. So I'm looking at this period as part of my life, as it were, that was never really adequately attended to by historians, by scholars, by journalists, or by others who simply let this material lie without fully examining what it tells us, not just about our past, not just about our country, but also what it tells us about today. And I argue, you know, we talk a lot about the systemic violence of the so-called new Jim Crow, about mass incarceration. But unless we fully understand the nature of the old Jim Crow, you can't really get the pathway, the links, the breaks in the links, the road, as it were, that takes us from that earlier period to our lives and circumstances today.
So beautifully said. And, you know, I got really like excited thinking about the historical work that you were talking about. And oftentimes people think historians' work is really boring. And that's also, I think, a problem of the ways that history is often taught to younger people as well. It seems like it doesn't have anything to do with them. It seems like it's just memorizing names and dates of people who, quote, won history, right? But it's really investigative, and to be able to, like, you know, go into the archive, like you said, find that one letter, and then to use that, like, it's very Carmen Sandiego for my folks out there, you know, to use that to then go to another archival source, whether it's a newspaper, you know, Ancestry has changed the game in allowing us to go Absolutely. Through census records so readily, and to find people who, again, are lost in some ways, but can be, you know, recovered. That does bring me to, you know, another part of the question, which is thinking about how you were able to work with your students and other community historians, people who are, quote, outside of the ivory tower, as folks would say, on bringing their research together in this book. And something that I thought of while I was reading this was a former student of mine. Her name's Sarah Kaufman. She is at Rutgers right now in her second year of her PhD. And one of her research interests was thinking about this everyday violence of Jim Crow, specifically in Chicago, and housing violence in the 40s and the 50s. And she did this really cool digital project that has stayed with me, mapping out the racial violence of that era and thinking about how, again, this is 1940s, 1950s Chicago, and people getting their homes bombed and mobs showing up at people's homes. This is not something that we talk about in terms of the history of Chicago. And that's student work, right, that informs me. Can you talk about how working with the students and other historians helped to shape this work?
So thanks, Courtney, for the question. This work, it's 15 years of work.
A lot of work, y'all.
We began this project in 2007. What launched the project was an initiative, a federal initiative, to go back and look at old cases from the more sort of traditional traditional civil rights period, 1960 forward. And we said, okay, that's all well and good, that should be done. But there is this sort of lacuna in the archive from 1930 to 1940. No prosecutions are ever going to emerge from this. However, the families deserve to know what transpired, and we, Americans, deserve to know how this interweaves with our larger understanding of the 20th century. And so students would pick up a case, like the Ollie Hunter case that I just mentioned, and they'd start digging. And we had with us one student who was an expert genealogist, a real fan of Skip Gates's
Same.
Work. And he left our law school and he went to work for Ancestry in Utah. Anyway, so he was able to find this woman, Ollie Hunter. And so the students, you mentioned the students, it's not just a student project. This project could not have resulted in both the book and the archive without showing the students the need to respect multiple forms of knowledge practice and knowledge creation. So the students have to fully understand that they could bring, you know, their skills, their expertise to the table, and they also had to understand and appreciate the vernacular history that was held, is and continues to be held in families and in communities. And so we traveled. You had to be there to know there. So we traveled to little places like Donaldsonville, and we met with families, and we sat across their kitchen tables, and they brought out their Bibles with their newspaper articles, their, you know, yellowed newspaper articles, and they'd say, okay, the profs and the students are here. Everybody would come in from around the community, and they would talk to us about their memories of what transpired. And they all had memories. Everybody had a memory. In one case, out of Mississippi, a little small town in Mississippi, a man had been shot to death in his home. What they remembered, what many of those folks remembered, was not the man, but they remembered passing by that house year after year with all its bullet holes in it as they went to school. And so those stories, that local history that was didn't come from a university setting, was equally vital to reproducing the meaning, to creating meaning out of these events.
That's so important. That's another thing we do as historians is try to make meaning for folks so that they can, you know, feel moved by it in order to do something, whether it's learn more about their own histories, right? Because we all have these in our families and in our communities. If we want to do that work, right? If we want to ask those questions, but also, like you said, as Americans, this is part of our history. Those lives for those people, the things left behind, they inevitably matter. So this book is also largely a commentary on how the law broadly at the local, state, federal level has been complicit in the everyday violence of Jim Crow. And as I was reading this, that there were a lot of passages that I was writing, sounds familiar, underneath kind of the ways that investigations, quote unquote, and, you know, processes that have to happen in order for, quote, justice to be served and evidence need to be collected. I think there's one passage where you say it was a shoddy investigation that was more about concealing than revealing something, which, I mean, bars. Hot bars. Are you a rapper? Not really. You know, to me, that is still related to a lot of modern day calls about thinking about what the law really is. I mean, I even think about John Lewis here, you know, the need to, if something is unjust, you have to make good trouble out of it.
Well, so two things on that. First of all, yes, obviously the book is about continuities such as they are, but it's as well about discontinuities. This is a work of scholarship, by the way. It's a work of scholarship for people who want to know more about American history and the ways in which American law, both nationally, federally, and locally, conspired to invisibilize the violence that defined African American life during a particular period. It's also about the ways in which authoritarian states were allowed to exist within a broader purportedly democratic polity. So you have these states in the South where people are subjected to this kind of violence and they can't vote, and there's a relationship between the violence and the disfranchisement because they can't vote. They can't put in a sheriff or a local official who, you know, something happens to your kid today, you can call your local, whatever it is, wards, whatever it is here in Chicago, right? Thank you, Alderman, and say, look, buddy, you know, I voted for you, I went out and worked for you, get to the bottom of this for me. That couldn't happen down there because you didn't know anyone. You didn't know anyone that you could call. And that was because you were disfranchised. And the violence also reinforces the disfranchisement. So you have this, you know, this interweaving, interlocking system in which the violence just keeps, you know, rotating. But, you know, having said that, what I also have, and obviously, yeah, are we confronted with racial violence today? But we also have to appreciate, as I said, the ruptures and the discontinuities, and the fact that number one, we do vote today, and number two, you're not likely to get killed for failing to say yes, sir, to a white man in the street, or walking in the archive, by the way, or walking on the wrong side of the sidewalk, a case in the archive, or standing on the wrong side of a line waiting for a movie, a case in the archive, or picking up a can in a store, Ollie Hunter. You're not going to get killed for that today. Right? You just are not going to get killed for that. That's not to say that more work to do, obviously. Not to say that we don't live in a very, very dangerous and fragile moment where our democracy is, you know, on the edge of a sword. All that is true. But we also have to appreciate that that was a different time. And we have to appreciate what it was like to live. And also the other thing is, you know, class can protect you from random violence today. That wasn't true back then. There were class distinctions. Some people had automobiles. They didn't have to ride in the buses. But class was not an insulator in the same way that it is today. So there are many differences. And then on the other question you ask about you know, the legal system, the book is also about the ways in which which the federal government, we often look at our federal government and we say, okay, that's where the solution is going to come from. What I do in this book is I trace the federal relationship, the relationship of our Department of Justice with Thurgood Marshall and the NAACP and the local folks who were fighting these cases, and the way in which the federal government, first of all, there was no federal agency addressing this sort of thing until, folks, 1939. So we're talking about 1865, the end of the Civil War, to 1939, when the federal government finally decides it needs a place, a space, a voice to address anti-black violence. And so that tells you a lot right there. And then the book also looks at the role of the Supreme Court in minimizing the consequences of violence for everyday black life, in describing this as a local problem. Let the folks down there in Donaldsonville deal with that. We have more important things to do in Washington. And obviously, because it's all about the 40s, it's not just about the DOJ, it's also about the War Department. And the way the War Department, when black soldiers are traveling across the South, I have the story of Booker Spicely, black soldier from Durham, North Carolina, in uniform, gets on a bus at Saturday night trying to get back to Camp Butner, his base, from Durham. Another white soldier gets on the bus, and the driver says to Spicely, both of them in the same uniform, "You move back so the white soldier can take your place." Spicely, who's from Philadelphia, says, "I'm not accustomed to this." And one thing leads to another. Spicely realizes he said too much. And so he walks towards the front of the bus to get off the bus. And he apologizes to the bus driver, "Man, if I bothered you, I'm sorry." Too late. He gets off the bus. The bus driver follows him off the bus and shoots him right there in the streets of Durham, North Carolina. Gets back on the bus and drives and finishes his route. Now listen, folks, we found that, well, you know, there'd been some other articles, but nothing, nobody knows the name. Maybe Maceo Snipes, people, that's a familiar name to people. No one knew the name Booker Spicely. So we dug up that name, we met with the family members, and now there is a really strong group of local activists in Durham, North Carolina, who are trying to lift up his name, get markers, and get an apology from the bus company, and that sort of thing. So anyway, he dies, and with him, essentially, dies his story.
Heartbreaking. That was one of the names I read because again, the regularity, but how violent that was. And not only for obviously him and his family, but the other people who were around who had to see that. We don't talk enough about, you know, that, you know, second degree trauma from witnessing that violence. But that has roots in, you know, slavery as well. And so, you know, just deeply, again, disturbing. The ways, something that I learned a lot about from this book was the way that extraditions worked. And you talk about how, you know, the ways that it seems like the fugitive slave law extends into a different iteration of itself during the Great Migration period, where some African Americans are literally fleeing for their lives and running away to the north to try to escape what they know could either be, you know, chain gang prisons at best, and a very violent, you know, either physical assault and or death from, you know, a mob or whatever, in the South. Can you, you know, share a little bit about what that
is about? Right, so in the first chapter of the book, I try to reprise a latter-day Underground Railroad, in effect. And as you say, it's the individual stories, and I think I tell three or four stories of folks using Detroit really as a locus here, because Detroit had an extraordinarily strong activist movement, biggest NAACP chapter in the country, strong labor movement, obviously, strong left socialist movement going on in Detroit, and all of this forms the sanctuary reality for folks who are running for their lives from the South. And, you know, the stories are really about the ways in which these paths that we think are long buried, these paths, pre-Civil War paths, which were used by slaves and we now think are long buried, you know, are revived. And it's not just about the individual journeys from the woods, the backwoods and swamps of place like Mississippi and Georgia, to places like Chicago and Detroit. But it's also, I tell here, this is a story of resistance, and here I'm talking about legal resistance. I'm talking about the very sophisticated legal tools that lawyers in these cities, and there are African-American lawyers whose work has not been fully appreciated. In the 1930s, we know, Thurgood Marshall, Charles Hamilton Houston, those folks obviously important, but you know, these are local folks who understand their local politics, mm-hmm. also have to understand, if they're in Detroit, they have to know something about international law as well, because some of these people make their way from, or they help them make their way from Detroit over into Canada, and they have to know, am I going to appeal this case before a governor, before an executive authority, or should I go to a court? And if I go to a court, am I going to a federal court? Am I going to a state court? So these are very calibrated, delicate, and extraordinarily complex legal questions that this legal community in these two cities, both Chicago and Detroit, that's where this stuff was going on. A little bit in Los Angeles, a little bit in New York, but we're really talking Chicago and Detroit. And there's, you know, I traced the work of one lawyer in Detroit, also a poet and an actor, who handled 100 extradition cases during his lifetime. And so, you know, I'm trying to, again, lift up the intellectual reservoir of resistance that was brought to bear on this rendition period, and also the ways in which rendition begins to knit together and this is not new to me, people who work on the migration have talked about this, but how you now begin to have one African American community. Right, so you have these folks who are up in Detroit, Chicago, and their folks are still back home, right. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to get them out. Mm-hmm. And so you have these linkages between the folks at home, the folks in these small towns, and the folks in these larger cities, and they're sharing information and knowledge and practices of resistance that together ultimately create one African-American world, aided, of course, by our newspapers and our music and all of that stuff. But this is certainly one feature of it.
Absolutely. And that, you know, when you think about the Great Migration, it's not just the people who left, but the many people who got, you know, like left behind, and how those links didn't end. That's even how we end up in an Emmett Till situation, right?
A lot of people didn't
want to leave. Exactly.
I mean, you know, remember, you know, the person who leaves, what is it about you leave? Home must be the mouth of a lion in order for you to leave. You know, they only leave home if home is the mouth of a lion. So, and that's true for migrants today, just as it was back then.
Absolutely. One question, and I only have a couple more questions. I know we'll have Q&A soon enough. But the one question that I thought, or one issue that you explore well in the book and gives me life, I was telling you earlier when, you know, I'm looking at photographs from these time periods, oftentimes I'm thinking, what happened to those folks who were part of this violence, right? Who helped enact this violence, who were bystanders in the violence? And you're able to undo some of that anonymity of the everyday violence, and you know, the white folks and the white system that allowed for things like this. Was there any fear around doing any of that, or how did you do that?
So this is not an easy question. And so the work is really about, as I said, it's about federalism, it's about resistance, and it's about the nature of the violence. Those are my three themes. But obviously, I'm naming. But I don't want this book or this work to be about naming and shaming. Mm-hmm. Is there something to name and shame? It's the system. That definitely needs to be named and shamed, and I hope I do that well in the book. But it's not a work that's meant to say, think about what, you know, your Uncle Dan did way back then, or think about, you know, your cousin who was the sheriff and killed four or five black folk and then got reelected and served the sheriff for another 10 years, in the book, by the way. It's not so much about that, but it is about, you know, fully explicating and exploring this history and these individual stories. And at the end of the day, we are talking about individuals. And so I'm a little bit of two minds about this. I don't want the book to be read as, you know, creating greater divisions in our deeply divided and fractured culture and country. But I do want it to be about, let's learn from how these cases ended up under the rug, how it ended up that, you know, I have a George Floyd case. Yes. In the book. I end the book with a man killed in 1942 in Florida, named George Floyd. And he's killed in a police station. This guy is a turpentine worker. Never married, no children, him and his wife. He's 52 years old. On a Saturday night, he and his brothers go out to have a drink. He gets busted for drunk driving, ends up in a police station in Florida, thank you. It's in the book. But he ends up in a
Go to the source. I'm going to the source.
He ends up in a jail cell. And he searched once by the
St. Augustine. St.
Augustine. He searched once by the police officer, by a jailer. And then the police officer who busted him comes along and says, I want to search you. He said, they already searched me. The police officer then beats him to death in the jail cell with all the his fellow prisoners or, you know, arrestees, and all the jailers watching. We know about George Floyd number two. Who knows about George Floyd number one? Not only don't we know about him, we don't know where he was buried. We don't know who preached his funeral, right? We don't know what happened to the police officer who killed him, except that he wasn't prosecuted. And he deserves to be lifted up.
Again, saying their names. Do I have time for one more? I think so. So, a good thing, What advice do you have for folks in the room who are interested in either doing the kind of historical recovery work that you've been doing and or interested in the law and, you know, justice, seeking justice in the legal system? Do you have any advice for those folks in the audience?
Well, for those who are interested in the historical material, as you mentioned, Courtney, there really is no better time to do this material. We produce, by the way, an archive of 1,000 cases of anti-black violence from 1930 to 1954. The archive is called CRRJ Archive, one word, CRRJArchive.org. And we hope that this will generate contacts with family members with whom we've not been in touch. It's not a Southern project. For us, this initial project was a Southern project. It's an American project. Mm-hmm. And so you do it wherever is most appropriate for you and for what you know and what has meaning for you. And I just go back to what I said at the beginning, which is, you know, if these stories get lost, they get left behind, we don't have anybody but ourselves to blame for that. And so, you know, you got ancestry, everybody's on there trying to find out who their relatives are. This work is part of our ability now. We have the fact that these materials are digitized, and my job as a member of the Cold Case Review Board, the Federal Cold Case Review Board, will be to get appropriate documents out there, digitized and available to the public, so you don't have to go up to Washington to find them or hire a historian to find them. It's a moment. It's a really important moment in our ability to, because of the tools that we are available to us now, to capture history that would otherwise disappear.
Well, I think we are supposed to now transition to audience questions.
Yes, thank you. I see some hands raised over here. Myself and my colleague will be around to pass the microphone. If you have a question, please just raise your hand. We ask to keep questions very brief so we can get to as many of them as possible.
Your first question's here.
You mentioned you had over 1,000 cases. I'm curious if you plotted them across county, states, whether you found clusters to sort of identify that society group different from one 4 counties away.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can't really tell you what those clusters are. What I will tell you is that the archive will make it possible for other scholars, not me. I put it together. I threw it out there. Now, other scholars will be able to come and examine the archive and explore what it tells us. First of all, as I said, about the link between this past behavior and what we see today. And there are a number of sociologists. I have a good friend named Jeff Ward and David Cunningham at University of Missouri, St. Louis. There are a number of sociologists who are working to discover what the relationship, you know, it's common knowledge, widely accepted and proven that what happened then, you know, bears on where we are today. But there are links in our knowledge about how that happens, how it gets transmitted. You know, these people, folks who didn't live through these experiences, what is it about the folks who live in those counties today that links them back up to those experiences that we don't know enough about? We really don't know enough about how that happens. We know that if you look at counties where there was massive violence or large numbers of lynchings, those will also be counties where there's greater use of corporal punishment, or the death penalty, you know, or where, you know, where you have coroners who make more mistakes. So those are the kinds of of correlations. Whether they're causal or not, we don't know. But those are the kinds of correlations that other scholars will look at through the archive.
Got your next question over here to the right.
Professor Burnham, one of the things you discussed in your book is the need for reparations and to honestly come to terms with what happened. And you made a comparison, I believe, to other countries that have had enormous human rights violations, and that some countries actually have done the difficult work of presenting an honest record, coming to terms with it, and offering reparations. What do you see as holding back the United States from making that kind of progress?
You read the
hard
book.
Question.
You read the book. Yeah, I argue, first of all, I argue that repair is necessary until the wrong has been corrected. And here I use an example, folks. I'm from Boston. So, you know, I talk about the history of Boston as far as anti-Irish bias, prejudice, discrimination is concerned, which defined our city for decades into the 20th century. It's not true anymore, right? So not only will you not see "No Irish Need Apply" signs, but you know the Irish American community is fully integrated into every aspect of life in the city of Boston, economic and otherwise. And so that those wrongs have been superseded. And I argue that until they are superseded, we have a duty to address them. And so that's the larger argument for reparations. And I suggest that, you know, there are some countries, and you know, I use Germany as an example here, that have, you know, deeply instantiated a past history of wrongs into their everyday life. You walk through a street of Berlin and you stumble across these markers where Jews once lived and were then and perished in the Holocaust. It's in the book. It's in the school books. Right. It's in the libraries. There, you know. So it. I'm not saying Germany's not. No, there's no perfect example, but that work has to be done in order to reach the point where you can say we have superseded this. And until that work is done, reparations has to be on the table. And it's a complicated question, reparations. And what I argue here is not complicated, is reparations for the folks whose cases I have excavated and now present in the archive. We know who they are. We know what they, you know, we can calculate what the damage was to them. This is 1940. We're not talking slavery here. So, you know, all the who, when, why, how much of reparations that we have continued to discourse around, importantly so, those are solid factors with respect to this particular case. And yes, I do argue that repair is the business of repair of the 20th century is the business of the, borrowing here from Du Bois, I know he'll forgive me, is the business of the 21st century.
All right, I have your next question over here.
Thank you for the book. Look forward to enjoying more of it. The parts I've read so far made me a little bit embarrassed for my teenage self. Growing up in Oklahoma in a small town, you know, we had the benefit of starting kindergarten and going to school with, you know, kids of all different races and such, but we just couldn't understand why our parents, you know, and our grandparents especially, couldn't look white people in the eye and, you know, would move off the sidewalk and that sort of thing. And in our teenage wisdom, we thought, man, if you guys had the same mindset that we have now, you know, maybe things would be different. But just wondering if you might say more about, you know, the impact of the system on those, you know, who were there in the years and the decades, you know, even after some of the cases.
Thank you for that. Right, thank you for that. So, you know, let me tell a story here. I'll make it brief. I know our time is coming to a close. One of the cases in our archive involves a man who was killed in 1942 in Algiers, which is a small town on the other side of New Orleans. So you got the river in between. It's still Orleans Parish, but it's on the other side. This man, it's 1942, he's walking from church with his wife and two small children. And some white soldiers are on an viaduct above him. They throw beer down on the wife and the child. And Edwin Williams protests, and he says, what'd you do that for? You know, you had no business doing that. Long story short, the men come down, the three young men, they're all in their 20s, they got their sailor uniforms on, they come down from the viaduct, they're drunk, and they had the beer bottle, and they slash him to death in front of his wife and children. And we got the case, and one of my students, she's a Canadian-Irish woman, name is, anyway, she's able to reach one of the children who was there in 1942. He was a child in 1942. Now he's, by the way, he's the minister of the church that the family was headed to in 1942, Wednesday, going to prayer meeting. And he's the pastor of that church, the beautiful Zion Baptist Church in Algiers. And she talks to him, and he says, you know, has anything like this ever happened to you? And she said, no. And he tried, they just cannot get over this gulf of his experience and hers. And I said to her, I said, you got to go down to Next Generation. And she does, and she reaches finally the grandchildren, who would be like Courtney's age. And they say, we knew something had happened to our grandfather. We thought he got into a fight and got the short end of the stick. We had no idea what it was. And this explains to us why our grandmother was always the way she was. And they, the grandchildren, then go to back to the parents and say to the parents, we need to talk about this. And so just to wrap this up, on Juneteenth, which was, as you all know, Father's Day, we all went down, this young woman, my law student, went down to the beautiful Zion Baptist Church, and they had a ceremony at the church, and all the kids, the wife is obviously dead, but all the kids, now in their 70s, were there with, you know, their whole family. And, you know, this is black life, you know, some of the kids did well, some of the kids are doctors, you know, that kind of thing. They're all in there. And now they have the full story. And so that's what the archive can do for you. Well, but so, you know, how did this case come to be? The wife, the day after her husband dies on the sidewalk in Algiers, she goes down, she crosses the river to New Orleans and meets with the local NAACP director, who carefully takes down her account of what happened and sends it to Thurgood Marshall. Anyway.
We have to tell our stories. Yeah, that's, you know, that healing can only come from being able to tell those stories in our own families. We have no idea oftentimes why so-and-so is how they are or whatever, and then you know.
Got your next question up here.
Hello, Dr. Burnham. I'm grateful for your work. I'm a retired Chicago public school teacher, and when I taught 7th, 8th grade on the South and West Side, I attempted to have my students gather oral histories from their families during holiday breaks. But understandably, because of the generational trauma, a lot of the older folks didn't want to discuss it. And there was such rich histories in those neighborhoods, you know, right where King marched. But do you have templates or some type of education materials that teachers can utilize so they can approach their families and teachers can address this living history while everyone is still able to tell their stories?
Yeah. It's a great question, and it's two parts. Number one, do we have pedagogical material for, you know, all grade levels? The answer is not yet. We will. And number two, what happens when people don't want to tell their stories? And, you know, these stories, as I've told them, I tell them as the American story, because we don't know that, you know, we got all these books out about World War II, about the Greatest Generation. This is all missing from that.
1,700 books on Lincoln.
I tell them about, you know, that these stories are part of very much part of the American story. But it is also true of their family stories. And so the gentleman I was telling you about, the you know, Reverend Williams in Algiers, if he doesn't want to talk about it, then okay, that's okay. If you don't, you know, if this is something that you think should stay in your family, we have to live with that. That's just okay. So I think it goes both ways. And, you know, obviously it's the trauma. It's the reliving. With respect to Reverend Williams, we call him the next day after he had talked to the student. And his wife said she had to walk him down the river back and forth the day after she called him. He hadn't thought about this. Not only had he not thought about it, he didn't know the full story of how his father died until we got to him. And so that's an individual thing. If you want to make this what it should be, which is it's your family history, but it's also our history, our Black history, our American history, you should. And if you don't, well, then that's just okay.
All right, I have your next question over here.
Professor Burnham, as a result of your research, have any of the communities, like the small town in Georgia or Durham, North Carolina, have they had any commemoration, apology from the city council, any kind of anything in the local history museum, anything like that to acknowledge the terrible acts that were committed?
Yes, thank you for that. We always try to, first of all, in terms of obviously this material is part of what the folks at the Smithsonian have called restorative history. So they've got a new unit at the Smithsonian. Bunch, who was head of the Black Smithsonian, is now head of the whole Smithsonian, and he's created this new unit, Lonnie, thank you, called Restorative History. And so, obviously, it's got to get in the libraries. It's got to get in the museums, and it's got to get, and it also has to in some way influence the way these small local communities begin to appreciate their history. The larger cities, Mobile, places like that, Birmingham, places like that, there are nice repositories of African-American history. When you get down to a place like Donaldsonville, there's very little Black history. I don't want to disparage anyone here, but the sons and daughters and grandsons and great grandsons of the Confederacy, they own the history down there. They still own the history down there. If you look for the Donaldsonville History Club or History Museum in any of these places, that's who owns that history. I could tell stories all day.
I'm excited for dinner.
Last question, right up here in the front. This will be our last one of the evening.
Thank you. Thank you for this informative presentation. But one of the questions I have is, you've talked about people who were killed, but what did you get into the impact of women who were threatened in other way, who were raped, who had violence,
yeah,
and that has clearly impacted generations, but probably is not talked about the same way? Were you able to recover any of that information?
So yes, the story, obviously, so this is the gender question, as it were. And you know, I'm with this guy named Marie Matsuda, who I think her one of her greatest contributions is always ask the other question. If you ask the race question, ask the gender question. If you ask the gender question, ask the class question, right? So thank you for that. And if you ask the class question, you know, ask the sexual question, right? So on the question of gender here, you know, I start with Ollie Hunter and others like her, and I also lift up forms of resistance that were gendered that I find in the archive. For example, the resistance of women on buses. This book is mostly about fatalities. And, you know, there's no way of, you know, the men were disproportionately killed. That's just the reality. The rape, so I'm not dealing with, you know, rape, and that's and other forms of violence that were also framed by Jim Crow and that are also evince anti-black hatred and violence, right? I'm not dealing with that, but you can't tell the resistance story without talking about women. Women were, you know, at the bottom layer of the resistance, the mid floor of the resistance, and the top floor of the resistance. There would be no resistance but for the role that women played. And I'm talking, you know, way beyond Rosa Parks. Very, you know, we're grateful for what she did. But it's also true that some of these folks have been turned into stick figures and stand-ins for forms and practices of relationships and resistance that go far deeper and are more complicated.
Folks, how about a huge round of applause for our panelists today?